Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us. Before we get started, I would like for everyone to stand as Major Markham makes her way to the stage to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Good afternoon. Please join me in the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. My name is Kim Long. I'm the Executive Director of Polk Vision, and I wish to thank all of you for being here today and also extend a deep, heartfelt bit of gratitude to Polk State College, who continues to be a strong supporter of all Polk Vision programs and provided this beautiful facility for our event today. This LEAD Forum, Mind, What Matters, is the first in what is planned as a four-part series focused on behavioral health and is produced through our Polk Vision Quality of Life team and our many, many partners in the health services community. It is an honor to have such an accomplished panel assembled here today. And to introduce and moderate today's discussion, we have County Court Judge Robert Williams for the 10th Judicial Court with offices in Bartow. Judge Williams, presently assigned to the problem-solving division of the Circuit Court. He began his legal career serving as an assistant public defender from 1982 until 1984. In October of 1984, he became an associate attorney with Bradley Johnson Law Firm, where he became a partner in 1986 and served in that capacity until 2006 when he was appointed to the bench by Governor Jeb Bush. And with that, I will turn things over to Judge Williams.
Thank you, and thank you, Kim. The first thing I want to do is welcome each of you. Thank you for attending and committing the time to what we think is an important event. I've seen some familiar faces as they walked in. We haven't been able to talk personally at this point, maybe a little bit after we will have some time. I want to first extend my thanks to our planning committee. We started gathering many weeks ago to discuss why this was important and how we would embark upon the process, and so they've done a great job, and the commitment of the panelists and others to the project has been inspirational for me. I want you to know that the purpose of this first program is partially contained in the title to it, where it talks about community engagement forum. It's kind of the subtitle to Mind What Matters. We want you to be engaged in this process today, and so we're going to talk about that and how you're going to be engaged, and many of you have received a responder as you walked in that will help you become engaged. So the purpose that I defined for the process of doing this today has to do with allowing our attendees to hear an overview of behavioral health issues that face our community. We believe this is a unique opportunity for learning and connecting, and as I said a moment ago, for engaging. And so we want to know your thoughts. We want to know what the needs are. And so this is the beginning of that process as we proceed. We have three quick questions to ask now and a few more to ask at the end of the forum. Your response to these questions will help guide us, as we plan for future forum events. So, come on up. So as we begin that process, let's go ahead and start with those first series of questions. Okay. Question, who are you representing? Pick the appropriate category and go ahead and respond to that with your responder at this point, if you would. We want full participation. I'm going to generally say that folks are close to finishing. I see one pretty well done at this point. We have 49 responses. Okay, let's move on. So, who's here? 41% are here because they were told they better be here. No. They are here as medical health care providers and as part of their employment or workplace. So we see 41 and 31% in those categories, and then it filters on down into those other groups as well. Good. As we said, we don't care why you're here. I mean, we don't care how you got here. It's just that you're here that matters to us. All right, let's move on. Based on your response to the question, who are you representing? Which of the following locations is the entity or group nearest? So pick that community maybe or section of the county, if you would, and chime in. Looks like we have 49 responses, now 52. Somebody didn't respond. Three people didn't respond the first time. It's okay. There you go. It was a warm-up. I like that. Perfect. Okay, let's move on. Now, I see many of you are from, Lakeland. Not surprising. Lakeland's the largest community in our county. We see quite a few from Winter Haven. We see quite a few from Bartow. So when you take those three in combination, it makes up the bulk. I suspect that those that are here because their job requirement or their jobs, their physical plant possibly located in Lakeland or Winter Haven or Bartow. So that's fine. Good. Let's move on to question three. My primary reason for attending is, pick one of those four responses if you would. Closing in, up to 53, 4, 5, 6. We're really getting warmed up now. 56 responses. Okay, let's take a look at what the answer is. Professional, occupational, to simply gain knowledge. I like that. We're all in the business of trying to gain knowledge, so that's a good thing too. So the vast majority are here for professional reasons and or for the purpose of gaining more knowledge. Good. Okay, now you have a little feeling of how it works. As we move on into the presentation, we'll do this again, kind of some different type of questions that we'll pose to you. All right, let me now take a moment to introduce our distinguished panel members, and I'm just going to go from closest to me and move down away from me. So bear with me. I think it's important that you know the walk of life that they come from. Dr. Risen Slate is a professor of criminology and chair of the Department of Sociology and Criminology at Florida Southern College. He serves as a crisis intervention trainer for police personnel and devotes much of his research to examining the interface of the mental health and criminal justice systems. Before becoming a professor, Dr. Slate worked within the justice system as a correctional administrator and is also a former federal probation officer. He has published articles on the topic of mental health courts and on the subject of probation officers as mental health specialists. He has spoken nationally and testified before U.S. Congressional Subcommittee on issues concerning law enforcement handling of persons with mental illness in crisis, and he is highly sought after as a speaker and media consultant. Dr. Slate. Dr. Daniel Haidt is a vice president of the Community Health and Medical Director of Infection Prevention for Lakeland Regional Health. From 1996 to 2013, Dr. Haidt served as the director of the Florida Department of Health in Polk County. He is board certified in both internal medicine and infectious diseases and is an associate professor at the University of South Florida's College of Medicine. He is a former president of the Polk County Medical Association and is on the medical staff at Lakeland Regional Health, Tampa General Hospital, and the Rohr Home Nursing Center. Dr. Haidt was elected a fellow of the American College of Physicians in recognition of his ongoing individual service and contributions to the practice of medicine. Dr. Haidt. Kirk Fossauer is the director of the Crisis Services for Peace River Center, where he oversees operations of the Crisis Stabilization Unit and the short-term residential treatment facility located at the PRC Bartow campus. Kirk has 30 years of various mental health and psychiatric emergency healthcare experience. He is a master certified instructor for the crisis intervention team training and is a consulting member of the crisis negotiation teams for Polk County Sheriff's Office and both the Lakeland and Winter Haven Police Departments. Kirk is also a trained crisis hostage negotiator and certified field traumatologist. Kirk Fassauer. Don Van Stee is the Administrative Director of Agency Operations and Compliance for Tri-County Human Services, Inc., and has been with Tri-County since August of 2002. A graduate of the State University of New York College at Brockport Master's Program, Don majored in health and toxicology. He brings to his position of over 40 years of business management experience and assures compliance with all federal, state of Florida, and accreditation regulation requirements to assure that Tri-County meets the highest level of treatment and support for the individuals the agency serves. Don Van Stee. Jeff Ware is the clinical director for the Winter Haven Hospital, Inc. Center for Behavioral Health. Mr. Ware has a master's degree in counseling psychology from the University of Southern Mississippi, is a licensed mental health counselor in the state of Florida. He has been employed at Winter Haven Hospital for 30 years, where he has served in various clinical and administrative positions representing children and adult outpatient services and community-based programs. Jeff Ware. Margo Fleischer is a program manager and trainer for Central Florida Behavioral Health Network, the managing entity for DCF-funded substance abuse and mental health services of Florida's 14 Suncoast and Circuit 10 counties. Margo has been a provider of behavioral health services for nearly 25 years and a licensed mental health counselor for 16 years. Margo's interests include trauma-informed care, services for women, families, and the homeless, provider and community education, evidence-based practices, and co-occurring disorders. Margo Fleischer. Let's give him a hand, please. At this point, I want to ask that Dr. Slate come forward and give his comments to us.
Thank you, Judge Williams. It's a pleasure to be here, and I appreciate all of you all being here as well today. And as you may see by the agenda, I'm not going to speak too long, as King Henry VIII said to four of his six wives, "I won't keep you long." How about that? But what I want to talk about today, I got a little slideshow here, and I'm going to start out with some of the reasons that treatment falls short for individuals within our community who have mental illnesses. One of them is the inability to pay, and of course, maybe the elephant in the room is that half-cent sales tax that's out there. That is one thing that has certainly come together to help to ensure that indigent people have the ability to pay for health care and to receive help and to keep them from falling through the cracks of the criminal justice system or the mental health system. Another term is anoxignosia. Anoxignosia is a term that really is oftentimes used with stroke victims, where they think that they can move their right hand, but they really can't move it. And it's referred to in the mental health side of things as a lack of insight. There's been books written about it, but basically, many people who are mentally ill, people say, well, why don't mentally ill people take their medication? Well, one of the reasons they won't take it is because they don't think they're sick, because they lack the insight into it. So they need to be surrounded by people that they trust, loved ones, friends, who can recognize when there may be a problem and get them to help if it exists. But hopefully, it will exist based on what we're talking about here today. And also, there is stigma. There's a great stigma within our society. There's great shame regarding mental illness. There should not be, but there is. I must say that the former U.S. Surgeon General David Satcher said, that the number one inhibitor for individuals with mental illnesses receiving treatment in this country is stigma. It's the shame of being mentally ill. You know, someone who is mentally ill, who has a crisis, people don't show up with a hot casserole. They run the other way, and we should not do that. A mental illness is no different than someone who has diabetes. They're both chemical imbalances, and we should not treat people differently because they have a mental illness in our society. And then you'll see the little slide there, or the bottom of the slide says, mistakes by clinicians. Indeed, clinicians, I'm not saying that they choose to, but I think sometimes clinicians actually make mistakes in diagnosing mental illness and trying to treat it. And I'm going to talk about that with a little story here in a moment or two. What I'd like to do next is actually go to this sequential intercept model. I don't know if anybody's ever seen this. But the sequential intercept model is really applying a perfect model to an imperfect world, okay? And ideally, everything would be caught at the top of this model if we had the best clinical practices in place. That would be the ultimate intercept where we could stop people from funneling into the criminal justice system. But unfortunately, the criminal justice system, in many respects, has become the de facto mental health system. And for a number of reasons, which I don't have time to get into right now. But the bottom line is, if people aren't properly trained at that best clinical practices intercept, and if we don't have the services at that intercept, then people are going to be coming into the criminal justice system. And I must say, not just because we're here on near Sheriff Judd, but I must say that Sheriff Judd has done an excellent job with that first component, law enforcement emergency services, crisis intervention team training. I'm sure Kurt Fassau will probably talk about that some. And we also have an intercept with initial detention hearings, people such as Judge Williams, who can identify people who have mental illnesses and link them to treatment. And then we have a special, the next component, court. We have a special behavioral health court, and there's other problem-solving courts, such as veteran courts, et cetera, that can identify people and begin to link them to treatment and keep them from recycling back through the criminal justice system. Yeah, I mean, you talk about something that's costly. It's extremely costly for people to keep recycling through the system. And so even with reentry, you can link people to services in the community and so on and so on. But the key, again, is that at every one of these intercepts, you have to have people that are properly trained to recognize the signs and symptoms of mental illness and also the services that are available in the community to link individuals to. And that's what the rest of these panelists will be talking about here today. With that said, is there anyone in the audience that speaks Mandarin Chinese? Good, this is kind of a modern interpretation of these symbols in Mandarin Chinese, but crisis in Mandarin Chinese is characterized by two symbols. And one of those symbols is danger, and the other symbol is opportunity. And if you think about it, in any crisis, there is danger, but there's also opportunity. This may be the opportunity to change someone's life in a positive way and to get them linked to treatment so that they do not, again, recycle through the system or even come in for emergency medical treatment or something of that nature. So with that said, I want to say to you that I can't say that word in Mandarin Chinese, but I have lived it. I know what crisis is. And I'm going to tell you a little story and talk about that a little bit. And as I tell you that story and as I talk about it, I want you to think about particularly those last three, anosognosia, lack of insight, stigma, and mistakes made by clinicians. And I also want you to think about the sequential intercept model and the intercepts in my story and what happened, okay? So, you know, back in the day, before I got all this gray beard and stuff, I had a master's degree from the University of South Carolina, and I walked out of the University of South Carolina ivory tower, so to speak, and I took a job as a United States, I took a job before United States probation officer as administrative assistant to the warden at a medium maximum death row facility in Columbia, South Carolina. We had two executions within the first 2 years there, very stressful environment. The main building at the prison was an old granite structure, five-tier, which you would typically see in movies with granite structure, and when it would rain, it'd be up to their knees, the inmates' knees in that building, built in 1866. So it was a terrible, awful, depressing environment. And as a result, the stress became so much that I had started having trouble with my appetite, and I had trouble sleeping. And so I went to a family physician. And the family physician said, well, I think you have a situational depression. I'm going to put you on amitriptyline, and the symptoms will ultimately go away. And I didn't want to get addicted to a drug, so I said, when they go away, can I then quit taking the medication? And he said, sure enough, you can. So we had our second execution, the symptoms go away. And right after that, I quit taking the medication, and shortly after that, I got a job as a United States probation officer. I'm leaving the dreaded environment of the prison. I'm now going to this beautiful federal courthouse, marble floors, got a vehicle to drive all over South Carolina and supervise people under probation and parole supervision. And guess what? The symptoms came back. So I went back to the family physician. He gave me amitriptyline again. And it's on a Friday night before I'm supposed to go for federal probation officer training. They knew I'd intern there, so they knew I knew the job. I have a probationer who has been arrested in the previous week. He did not tell me. And, of course, if you are under probation, the first thing you're supposed to do if you get arrested, you're supposed to tell your probation officer. So I went to his place of work on that Friday night, gave him about 5 minutes to tell me. He didn't tell me. We had a verbal confrontation. And frankly, it kind of was a situation where it's almost a shoot, don't shoot situation. I vacated my nice federal car, went across the way, called for backup. And within 10 minutes, we all meet back over at the service station. And the cop said, did you ever unsnap your 38 revolver, your holster, that you were carrying? I said, no. They said, well, you're free to go. Well, I don't know what happened to Sydney, but I know what happened to me. I left on Sunday morning and went to Miami for federal probation officer training. My wife went with me. And when I got there, I literally believed that I was on the film set for Miami Vice. And I believed that I was going to encounter Sonny Crockett, and if anybody remembers Sonny Crockett, he was played by Don Johnson on Miami Vice. And so I got into an argument with a fella at the hotel who reminded me of my father. I knew he wasn't my father, but I thought he was playing the role of my father. And so the police are called. Basically, they take me with them, and they want to know who I am. And I said, I refuse to answer any questions unless those questions are posed to me by Sonny Crockett. And this female police officer, I guarantee you she had never had CIT training, she said to me, she said, well, that's not real. And I said, well, I don't care what's real or not. I'm not answering any questions. So about that time, they got me to Jackson Memorial Hospital. I was placed in all four-point restraints at Jackson Memorial Hospital. Interesting thing about it, at the prison, I had been in charge of writing the policy for four-point restraints. And I think anybody who writes policies for four-point restraints ought to be placed in them, you know? So anyway, I ended up being placed in four-point restraints. I felt that on the headboard behind me, there were cracks in the paint, and I felt that there were spiders crawling down onto my head, and I hate spiders. And so they had found by this time my wife, who had been with me at the hotel, and she heard the screams from me as I believe the spiders were coming down on me. What is all this? Well, I would come to find out that this was a delusion. It is a fixed false belief. You believe something, you believe it to be true, and nobody in the world is going to convince you otherwise. So in any event, they let me leave Jackson Memorial Hospital. They let me go back to Columbia if I will agree to be hospitalized. So I do. I agree to be hospitalized in Columbia. And in a two-week period of time, I met a psychiatrist. His name is Roger Deal. And Roger Deal said to me when he met me, he said, I got some good news and some bad news. And ever the pessimist, I said, well, what's the bad news? He said, well, the bad news is you're bipolar. And he said, also the bad news is, remember mistakes by clinicians? He said one of the worst things that family physician could have ever done was prescribe amitriptyline for you, because it's like pouring jet fuel on a fire. It brought the mania even further out. And he said he should have done a family history, et cetera, et cetera. And then he said the good news is you got to have above average intelligence to be bipolar. And I don't know if that's true or not, but, I said, okay, well, that's great. I said, but what does this mean for my life, right? And, he said to me, he said, you know what, young man? He said, that's the way I get my jollies. That's the way I get my kicks, is by taking people like you and putting you back together again to be a success. And I believed him. And you all may be in a position one day where you're looking at somebody and they're wondering, is there any hope for recovery? And I want you, if you walk away from here with nothing else, there is hope for recovery. There is hope for recovery. And so he got me back on the schedule, and he said, I don't know about you being a federal probation officer. He said, but who the hell wants to be a federal probation officer anyway? Well, I did, so I'm like, kind of tearing up. And so then he said to me the next week, because guess who comes in? My federal probation supervisor says, goodbye. There goes my job. There goes my federal benefits. They wanted me to resign for medical reasons. 1 week later, my wife came in, and she had backed up a U-Haul, and she had taken most things out of the house and ultimately divorced me. So I had to do a gut check. Am I going to stay around any longer? I decided I would. Thank God that I did. And I'm moving slides around up here. But in any event, I did decide to stay around. And at that point, I went back to my mother's in North Carolina. It's always good to have a mama. And I began to put my life back together. I was fortunate. I already had a master's degree. I started teaching at community colleges. I applied to 3 PhD programs. I got accepted at all three, and ended up going to California, Claremont, and got a full fellowship and stipend for living expenses. Go to Claremont, go to Maine, teach in Maine for 4 years, finish the PhD, come to Florida in 1993. By the way, all this circle, okay, I'm seeing doctors, I'm seeing psychiatrists, but I'm telling no one. Why? I am ashamed. I'm embarrassed to be mentally ill. So I don't tell anybody other than significant others and seeing doctors. But when I come to Florida in 1993, I get a psychiatrist out of the Yellow Pages. He meets with me about four times, and he says, you know what? I don't think you're mentally ill. I think you had a brief reactive psychosis to a stressful event that happened, 8 years ago. I said, really? And he said, yeah. And I wanted to believe him because I didn't want to be mentally ill. Within 2 months, he takes me off the medication. I end up at a football game in Columbia, South Carolina. I am so delusional that I believe that I can control the South Carolina Gamecock football players and make them run over the Georgia Bulldogs, and South Carolina will win. Well, that's before, Lou Holtz or Steve Spurrier. It didn't happen. Got mad about third quarter. Long story short, make it back to a condo. The police are called, and the police pick me up out by a swimming pool, and my wife is there, new wife, telling them, "This is my husband. He worked in this town as administrative assistant to the warden at that prison down the street. He was a United States probation officer in this town. He also has a PhD in criminology." And she said to them, "You know, please, please help him because this doctor has taken him off of medication that he should be on. Please help him." Their help for me, we go to the sequential intercept model. Number one, on the sequential intercept model, they did not have CIT training. Number two, on the sequential intercept model, they didn't bother telling anybody at booking at the jail that I was showing signs and symptoms of mental illness. I was placed in a holding cell. I was assaulted within an hour by another detainee who I got too close to in the holding cell. I actually made it through a magistrate, before a magistrate who I look back and he had real estate training. And when I make it before the magistrate, he sends me back down in and puts my bail at $500. I'd thrown my wallet away incognito. How do I get out of jail? A federal probation officer that I had worked with 8 years before got wind of the fact that I had been thrown in jail. He came down and he flashed his badge under no authority whatsoever and asked for my release. And so they released me to him and they told him that they didn't have a clue what to do with me. And I'll close this up right fast here. Here's the bottom line. If they don't have a clue what to do with me, at least Sheriff Judd has a crisis stabilization unit within the jail. If they don't have a clue what to do with me, I shouldn't be in there for treatment. And also, I don't think in our society that people should have to commit a crime to receive treatment within this country. And so I think we need formal structures in place, and they're going to talk about many of the structures. And Dr. Haight, I'm going to turn it over to him right now. He's going to talk about many of those structures that we already have in place here in Polk County. Had I been here when these things happened, it might not have been me up here talking today. All right, thank you very much.
Dr. Schlate shared a very moving individual story. But when I look out here, we must all have our own been witnesses to dozens of moving stories that bring us here today, that have involved a crisis, have involved a behavioral health, mental health, addiction health issue. Am I correct? Or just nod your heads that you have been there. And you've felt it, and you've experienced it, and you can share that story, and you know how sensitive it is, and you know all the barriers that are in place. So whether you're representing and you're here because you were working for an employer, or you worked with faith groups, or you're with the school system, or you're a first responder, you have that expertise. You already have it. You really know what to look out for, but you're still concerned because you know, like me, I'm not sure how to fully respond. How do I recognize things early? How do I prevent happening what you just heard? And I think you have seen those stories that turned out well, but I'm sure we've all had those personal experiences that didn't turn out well or could have definitely turned out better. So where does the healing start? How does it go from an event, something definitely not going well? How does it actually start to turn around? And I know it is, and it was mentioned earlier, it's that often that circle of trust we have around us. It could be our friends, our family. It could be our congregation, neighbors. You've maybe been that. You've been that neighbor. You've been that friend or that family member who was in that inner circle that that person was closest to and you recognized it first. Wouldn't it be great if there was like a first aid, like we have first aid for skinned knees and car accidents and other things that we know how to respond? It would be so helpful if you could go and get first aid for a mental health issue or a behavioral health issue. We have it for swimming and drowning prevention, right? We get courses on how to do that from little age on up. And I think moving in that direction is something where your feedback, is that possible? I think we'll hear something about this later from one of our panelists about can we get and move in that direction so we feel a little more comfortable and move past the stigma and make that recognition. But where else can we get help? And one of them I'm here to speak to you about is a place called a medical home. This is your doctor. I think as we get older, we start to make sure we have a good doctor we can turn to. That doctor should be somebody who knows you. The nurses there know you, the assistants, the nurse practitioners, they know you. They know you had your appendix out. So if you call 3 months later in the middle of the night with belly pain, they know it's not your appendix, right? So they know you. That's that medical home. And you go there and you may have, oh, how many of you had a family member with diabetes? Yeah, you know somebody with diabetes. That's a chronic disease. It stays with you. You manage it. You have ups and downs. How many have you known people have ups and downs, right? We all have ups and downs. We can give names to it. We can call it depression and anxiety, but it's ups and downs. Can you imagine the challenge in a doctor's office when you mix diabetes with a person who is having the ups and downs, maybe more down at the moment? Are you really going to check your sugar? Are you really going to stay on that diet? Are you going to take that extra walk? That's a big challenge. And you know what happens to the diabetes? Sugar goes up, weight goes up, blood pressure goes up, and you may be working on that heart attack or that stroke. But it's this environment where you can start to link the mind and the body together. Because that physician, this is where we want to have that healing start. We're not where it needs to be in the United States. We're not where it needs to be. Where your physician and nurse practitioner and your healthcare provider knows, I can see that we're not going to just talk about your blood pressure today. You look like you're having some ups and downs. And maybe it's your primary care physician that could be that first signal too that can help recognize this. So that's a good topic for the future. We want you all to think, what are going to be good things that our community needs to discuss? What are you most interested in when it comes to mental health topics? I'm just the first one here speaking about the doctor's office. Others are going to speak to other issues on how to recognize problems. What are your interests? But knowing that, it can start there. And I'll give you an example. In a few of the clinics throughout the Polk County area, we have, within the doctor's office, licensed mental health providers inside the doctor's building. Can you imagine a diabetic person who is having some ups and downs? They also have a little heart failure, they have arthritis, there's a lot of things going on, and they're definitely having a mental health issue, a behavioral health issue, or an addiction issue. Can you imagine just being given a phone number and say, here, call this number and set yourself up with an appointment? How successful is that? I mean, if you've ever been in that situation, that's hard. But what if I said that, you know, a few months ago when you came to the clinic for your blood pressure check and that, somebody poked their head in the door and said, hey, my name is Scott. I deal with things like ups and downs. If you ever want somebody to talk to, I'm here in the building. Oh, here's your doctor. I don't want to delay you. And the doctor comes in to visit. 3 months later, you're having those ups and downs. Doctor recognizes it. You share something with the physician and the nurse practitioner. And they say, hey, would you mind talking to Scott? You remember him? He poked his head in the other day. He's just 3 feet away. They can see you, and you're comfortable going there. That works. That really works. Now, the programs that I'm referring to have been in place now for a year or more due to the half-cent sales tax. So I'm really thankful that, and I'm glad it's on the ballot, that we get to decide whether to continue the half-cent sales tax. So that is definitely something covered. But that's a key issue, because now we're dealing with having that open conversation. And I guarantee you that doctor or nurse practitioner is not just saying, here, deal with this problem why I only deal with blood pressure and diabetes and sugar. No, it's a partnership. Can we get that throughout our community? It's not there yet, but I think it's going to be our voices saying it's important to us to have this. I think it's going to be a key factor in keeping us healthy. So when you think about how do we recognize issues and start to use that first aid, Maybe we can do it as a family, a friend, a neighbor, a congregation member, but we can also do it in doctor's offices, nurse's offices, places of employment. First responders, of course, a key issue there. And I think then from there, we start to then be able, can I recognize what is a minor issue and what is a serious issue that is way over my head? And that would be a crisis. How do we recognize a crisis? What is a crisis? How fast do I need to act? What can I learn, seeing as I'm not an expert in that area? Where is my comfort level is? And fortunately, we have an expert in crisis management and crisis recognition. That's Kirk Fessauer from Peace River Center. And I want to now turn it over to him to start to lead us into that area to say, how can we deal if we recognize a crisis?
Well, good afternoon, everybody. Glad you're all here today. Got to change my slide. Been cued.
Sorry.
Wait. There we go. All right. Thank you all for being here today. So, one of the pieces I've been asked to do is tell you what a crisis is in 10 minutes. All right, there's a crisis for you, okay? Because we get into crisis work with law enforcement officers in this community. It takes us 40 hours to talk about that and how to intervene with it. In a nutshell, as Dr. Slate had mentioned in his talk, a crisis is a critical point. Something needs to happen. Something has got to change, okay? Otherwise, the body is going to have some difficulty moving forward. Now, when we talk about crisis, we're here talking about emotional situations, mental health, behavioral health kinds of issues. But let's think about some other crisis, developmental crisis. We're growing up, something's not growing right, or we have aches and pains, right, in our body, and we go out and we see a doctor. Nobody thinks twice about that. We go see the physician. We have an existential crisis, a crisis of faith. We seek a minister. And we talk to the minister about what's in Scripture and how that can heal us and make us feel better. But then we have an emotional crisis. Something doesn't feel right up here. It's not quite clicking. It's not making a lot of sense. And that's where we stop. And the stigma we talk about here is what stops us from going forward. I don't want to be crazy. You're not crazy, you're human. You're human. Crisis can run the gamut to the very individual financial situation. It can be very situational, or something much longer term, a severe health condition, such as a mental illness. Not everybody is going to get a mental illness. Statistically, it's 1 in 5 individuals, according to the National Alliance for the Mentally Ill. 1 in 5. And those are severe situations, dramatic situations. We can all relate to being overly stressed and having a financial crisis or a crisis in our relationships. We all have those. There is a time, though, when things get so overwhelming. I like to refer to it as the emotional trash can. You know, you stuff stuff in there, things happen, we stuff it in there. What happens to the trash can after a while? It spills over, right? Well, you got some choices there. You can empty out that trash can, right? Or you can stuff it down, right? And you stuff it down after a while, and guess what happens? It gets all gooey down there, doesn't it? But you got more room to put more stuff in there. And then eventually you keep stuffing it down, it's going to flow over. And now it's all over the room, and it's all over the house. Now you're on hoarders because they got trash everywhere, right? That is a crisis situation. When we're continuously stuffing this stuff down, we should reach out. It could be a friend. It could be a minister. But there are times when that stuff is so deep down in there, we got to go in there. And anybody ever have a trash can they had to clean out at the bottom of? Like, you bleh, bleh. Right? That's counseling, people. That's what we get involved in. We dig deep and we get into the gooey, dirty, yucky stuff that a lot of people, including ourselves, don't want to even look at. but we look at that, because if we don't deal with that, the situation is going to get worse over time. So that's basically crisis in a nutshell, dealing with those issues. Okay, it taxes our coping mechanisms, our current resources. And hopefully a lot of us have something called protective factors, friends, family, church, other support groups. There are professionals out there who we can all turn to and speak to about particular issues going on when, maybe I'm not going to tell my friend about that. No? My friend John, I got a rash, John. I'm not going to, you know, John's going to be hounding me for days after that, you know? No, we go to speak with other people. There are other people out there who can intervene in those crisis situations 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And very often it's something as simple as picking up a phone. There are a few resources in this community, and quite honestly, we are blessed here in Polk County. We've got a lot of people who are invested in helping us in our mental health, our emotional health in this community. You know, we've got the CIT training that is offered to law enforcement and the agency. Sheriff Judd has taken the lead in that and really has grabbed onto it and owned it. And all my officers, all my deputies will be trained in this. It's like, oh my God, it's a lot. But yeah, it's happening. It's been in this community since 2004, and I'm happy to say we've trained over 2,000 officers, not just in the sheriff's office, but in Lakeland Police Department, Winter Haven Police Department, and some of the smaller municipalities in our community. These officers understand a little bit better about trauma, a little bit better about mental illness, and how to intervene in a verbal way so that we can get these people, get us to those resources that we need help with. Because nobody's going to pick up the phone and call Joe Mental Health when somebody's acting a little bit bizarre in the community. They're going to call law enforcement. They're going to call law enforcement. And those poor men and women, you know, they don't get a lot of training in the academy with regard to mental illness. So it's nice to have CIT training to augment the training that they already have. You know, we have, again, pick up the telephone. We've got 211. I see June out there. Hi, June. We have 211 out there, which is part of United Way initiative across our nation. You pick that up, you can ask for some information on what mental health resources are out there, what human services are out there in our community. Various agencies have crisis line. Peace River Center has got a crisis line. Write this number down, 519-3744. 519-3744. That's a 24-hour crisis line. Use it. Give it out. Hand it out. I don't care. Right on the bathroom wall for a good time call. You know? This is an important number to have at your disposal. There's a brochure out there from Peace River Center. We also have other crisis line services for domestic violence and rape recovery. Please, put this in your file. Utilize them. Call. Ask. The resources are out there. We have a crisis response team that can go out and come and speak to you. A counselor will come out and talk to you 24/7, 2 in the morning. You want to talk about your breakup with boyfriend, girlfriend? Hey, we'll come out and do it. 519-3744 is the number you need to call. You know, we're fortunate to have a number of various resources in our community. It's time to stop for all of us. Not just somebody with a mental illness, because that's the worst end of the spectrum. Crisis can happen to any of us at any given time. We've got to take that opportunity to stop and empty the emotional trash can. Thank you.
Go ahead.
Oh, I'm going to turn it over to Judge Williams.
We had dedicated this time for some questions. We don't quite have as much time as we need to have. Real quick one, we can maybe do two. What does CIT mean? We know who can answer that. Kirk?
CIT. Okay, it often gets confused that people say the T is for training. No, actually CIT is Crisis Intervention Team. The initial model, which comes out of Memphis, Tennessee, CIT was supposed to be a small group of volunteer officers, patrol-based, so they're out in the community, who would specialize in understanding working with individuals with mental illness. Over the years, as the movement has grown, it is an international movement now. CIT still means Crisis Intervention Team, but we are committed to training all deputies, all officers who are interested in learning more about mental illness so they can better serve the community.
Okay, do we have time for one more maybe quickly? I'm gonna say yes. If someone is Baker Acted, does it go on an arrest record? Does the Baker Act record follow a person? Which of our panelists want to handle that?
Hello? Okay, that's actually a complicated question. The Baker Act itself, no, does not go in your record. It actually gets turned into the receiving facility where somebody is brought to if they're taken into care. However, law enforcement, if they are involved, they have a record that they need to write in their report, and that is public record. So if they write anything within their report stating that they were taken to a receiving facility or a Baker Act was initiated, it'll show up there.
A little more time. Let's do it. What is the difference between a psychiatrist and a psychologist? How do you know which professional you need to see? It's a practical question. Who wants to tackle that one? Sure. Maybe two of you need to tackle it.
Yeah. You said a difference between a psychiatrist and a
psychologist.
Well, a psychiatrist is typically an MD who is specialized in a particular area, either adult psychiatry or child psychiatry, where a psychologist is usually a doctoral level who is not considered an MD and can do a certain type of evaluation and testing for psychological evaluations and such. Want to add something?
So just to add, you may often see where the psychiatrist may be very engaged in the management of certain medications as they prescribe, deal with side effects, deal with checking levels, and going through that process, and of course lending their expertise to helping manage the condition of the particular patient. The psychologist being really very much engaged in the counseling, the therapy sessions, and also providing very helpful advice for potential medications that the psychiatrist may consider, but they work together as a team. But I think we also should mention licensed social workers in mental health and also licensed mental health workers that are also there speaking with the patients, recognizing potential issues. Again, the same issues are counseling working? Are you getting family support? Are there other things in the community that could help you? Even working with getting transportation. So that's this entire team that pulls together, each one lending their own skills depending upon the needs of the patient. So let me know if I left anything out.
I think those are great answers. Time for one more? All right, let's tackle one more. My family member sees a psychiatrist, but I don't think he tells the doctor about all of his symptoms. Is there any way a family member can talk to the psychiatrist or send information to the doctor? Dr. Haight, you want to tackle that one?
Well, that's tough to tackle, and again, correct me if I'm wrong. I think absolutely things are held very private. Mm-hmm. So as far as a psychiatrist or any healthcare provider discussing care, even to the point of even acknowledging that the person is a patient, that is not happening. However, to send information in, I don't believe there's really any blockage in a brother or sister saying, I know you cannot acknowledge whether my neighbor, friend, brother, sister is your patient. I'm not even asking you to acknowledge that. But as a friend of this person, I just want to let you know, here is a concern I have. You know, I don't know if there's another suggestion.
No, that if you've got information, it is, and you feel it's important to get to somebody you think might be in care or who's caring for that individual, get that information there. We can hear the information, can't necessarily acknowledge that we're working with that person. You know, I can neither confirm nor deny. But that information still will be useful.
Okay, I think we're going to wrap that up at this point. Thank you for the answers. Good answers, good questions. Keep writing down questions, funneling to them to us, if you would, because we're going to have another little portion at the end to be able to do that as well. So let me transition at this point and surrender the podium to Don Van Stee for his comments. Don?
Okay, tell me how I changed a slide.
You're looking at the wrong person.
I did it. One little button. Thank you. I'm going to feel better standing behind the podium. That way you won't see me shake because I'm nervous. But up to this point in time, we've been talking about crisis and the crisis situation. Now I want to talk about after crisis, now what? If the decision when somebody, a patient has been in a crisis situation to continue treatment, questions often come up that goes, where do you go? Who do you see? How do I contact someone for help? And we've discussed that a little bit earlier. These are questions that individuals are going to ask when a friend, a loved one, or a spouse may need additional behavioral health services. Before I became employed at Tri-County, I would have asked these questions and even more because of the fact that if I had had a loved one that needed that information, I would have felt lost and not knowing exactly to who to turn to. But within 6 months of becoming an employee of Tri-County, I had a friend of mine call me and he said that his young adult son was having issues because he was withdrawing from an abuse of substances and that he was becoming withdrawn, antagonistic, and the parents needed answers regarding programs that treated substance abuse disorders, and additionally, the young individual had just been diagnosed as being depressive. The son was using drugs to assist him in minimizing his depression. The son's philosophy, if a little drug works good, a lot of drug will work a heck of a lot better. Does that sound familiar? Over the years, many individuals have contacted me about behavioral health services available in Polk County. When I ask them why they contacted me, they'd say it's because they didn't know who to turn to. They needed someone who would listen, to assist. They knew I was in the behavioral health field. To them, and as Dr. Slate stated, the stigma of having outsiders know that you have or they have a mental health or substance abuse disorder is one that's normally kept under wraps in many families. This prevents families from seeking help until the problem is what I call beyond just becoming a family matter. Traditionally, in the behavioral health field, after crisis has been addressed to a manageable level at the CSU or at the hospital. Referrals are made to treatment providers specializing in substance abuse disorders or mental health treatment. Once the primary diagnosis, whatever they're there for to that counselor, has been addressed, the patient could be referred for further treatment regarding their other issues, but often this may not occur. It may not occur because of barriers that the patient could not overcome or that the counselor may not have enough experience to recognize what other issues may be affecting the patient. The behavioral health field created what I call silos. A silo is one where it becomes very hard to overcome because you treat a specialty type of thing, and then leaving that silo and going someplace else is very difficult to refer and go in and out of. Fortunately, there are treatment options today that haven't existed in the last 5 to 10 years, and that is what we now call co-occurring treatment. Or co-occurring treatment means that agencies offer treatment that will not only deal with the primary diagnosis, but also the secondary diagnosis as well. Providers are moving into this treatment modality as a way to address not only the substance abuse disorder, but also the presenting mental health issue as well. Yes, many patients have more than one presenting problem in substance abuse, such as more than one drug of choice. Or it could be alcohol consumption. Or it could be abusing prescription medications. And at the same time, they could have more than one mental health issue, such as a post-traumatic stress disorder, or depression, or bipolar. In a co-occurring treatment facility, these issues may be addressed by either an experienced counselor or a treatment team that's trained in co-occurring disorders. Research has informed us that 53% of all substance abuse users in the United States have an additional mental health problem. Research also tells us that 60% of the mental health diagnosed individuals have substance abuse disorders. And so logic tells us that when that individual is placed in front of a counselor, he or she's not only looking at the primary diagnosis, but has to look at the secondary diagnosis as well. The consequences of undiagnosed and untreated or undertreated co-occurring disorders can lead to a higher likelihood of the patient experiencing homelessness, incarceration, medical issues, suicide, or even early death. People with co-occurring disorders are best served through integrated treatment. With integrated treatment, practitioners can address mental and substance abuse disorders at the same time, often at lower cost, and creating better outcomes. The Polk County Indigent Healthcare Plan recognized that co-occurring individuals could not be looked at as just a substance abuser or a mental health patient. And for the last 4 years, the Indigent Health Plan has funded agencies like Tri-County and Peace River Center to assist in providing needed treatment to the healthcare plan individuals. What are some of the challenges that treatment agencies like Tri-County and Peace River face in Polk County when offer co-occurring? The first, like Dr. Slade had talked about, is the necessity to reduce the stigma of having a substance abuse disorder or mental health diagnosis. Maintaining patient confidentiality is another problem that we face. In small communities like this, you can't talk about the 6'5" basketball player that plays on the high school team that's in your counseling chair looking for services. Those kind of things can happen here in a small rural area that Polk County is. We have to minimize the institutional feeling that somebody may go into for treatment. And we have to have, reducing that institutionalized thing will go a long way to reducing stigma and the labeling of a patient as being different. Second, the demands to hire and provide training and to periodically review professionals with the proper credentials and educational backgrounds to assist these patients that I've just been describing is difficult. We don't live in a metropolitan area where large treatment providers are there or other large services are available, and we have to offer more than just a paycheck. And it's very difficult to attract these people with those kind of credentials to come to Polk County. When you move into co-occurring, especially if you're a substance abuse provider like Tri-County was, and even to the point of what's happening now within the field of Medicaid, individual providers and or agencies have to apply for becoming on an insurance panel, because with Medicaid expansion and with the insurance companies now becoming involved in providing insurance for Medicaid payments, agencies and providers have to be on these insurance panels. And there's about 5 or 6 of them within Polk County that provide services, and providers have to be paneled for those kind of things. This is easier said than done, because back in 2014, Congress passed the parity law. And that means that substance abuse diagnosis and mental health diagnosis have to be treated and paid for just like a medical condition is treated for. So if you're there for a broken arm that the insurance pays for it, and in treatment, a lot of times you have to go into rehabilitation. And rehabilitation facilities are normally not a 5 or 10 or 20 day type of treatment like a rehabilitation facility would be if you're in for a surgery that you required rehabilitation. Am I doing something? Sorry. Well, they already know who I am, so thank you. Along with a part of the insurance panels you have is trying to negotiate the maze of the billing process. If a provider has accepted under the insurance, and then to be able to utilize that insurance payment in submitting the bills, claims have to be what we call clean claims, have to have all the information available that you can submit and go from there. Finally, how do you measure success? How do payers know what was spent did the most good? How is data applied to document successful treatment? Is the final authority the patient themselves, or is success defined by the amount of patients currently soliciting your practice to gate admission? Both providers and patients should know that a patient has a right to choose whether they where they select to go for treatment, and that success will dictate the provider's tenure into the future. One of the most important things that Dr. Haight talked about just a few minutes ago, and that is one of the new things now about putting licensed professionals in the doctor's office, where the doctor and the therapist can now get together, and where if the doctor determines that there may be some issues, that they can hand them and walk down that individual to that therapist, and the therapist can then work them up, do an assessment, and then provide a course of treatment, which may include going to a psychiatrist, and where the psychiatrist could provide medications for that individual. One of the nice things that's a part of that is that physicians for a long time in the primary care field have often wondered if the patient that they're seeing that may have a mental health and or substance abuse issue and on medications, they don't know what the medications are they're taking. So if the doctor prescribes a duplicate med, they won't even know. Or if the doctor prescribes a medication that is contraindicated to the psychiatric med, they don't know. But with the fact that you have an integration field now where the trained psychiatrist and the or counselor is in the same doctor's office, that information is put into the electronic health record, and the doctor knows exactly what the patient is doing. And then when the patient sees the doctor, the patient can feedback to the doctor the kind of things that the counselor is doing to help them with their mental health and or substance abuse issue. And I have to tell you that Peace River's been doing this with the hospital for the last several years, and Tri-County's been doing it with the federally qualified health plan called Central Florida Healthcare, and we've been doing it for the last 4 years, and the results are outstanding. Where you can have these kind of issues where the doctors and the counselors are together and you have a warm handoff with the patient is excellent. Finally, what is going to happen within the area of integration healthcare? And quite frankly, right now, nobody knows. It's an evolving practice. But I envision that someday, we're going to have a health center. And that health center, you can make an appointment to see your doctor. And if you have to have a group therapy, you can go through the group therapy. And you may have to have a dental appointment that could be in that same building. And oh, by the way, child care is provided at the same time. These things are now possible because of what's happening within the area of managed medical care. And now it's duplicate services or other services can provided the same day and paid for by insurance companies that before this time couldn't have been done. There's a lot of change that's going to happen. Co-occurring is the field now that takes the individual and treats them as a whole person. And integrating that care with the primary care physician is another step in making sure and ensuring that we have successful outcomes. Now, there are other ways of doing traditional types of care or alternatives to traditional care. And Jeff Ware from Winter Haven Hospital is going to hear and talk about that as well. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'd like to speak a little bit about access to care. As you know, we're in a very large county, And many of y'all probably put many miles on your car, is that right? So one thing that kind of came to mind is a real short story. I was at the office probably around 5:30, 6 o'clock a couple months ago, and there's a lady who was came over in her walker, and she had been seeing a counselor or one of our physicians, and she sat down and she was just sitting there quietly. So I went up to her and asked her, what's going on? What do you need? And she said, I'm just waiting for my transportation. She was waiting on her Medicaid transportation, which, they've got different schedules and how they pick up, individuals. And in talking to her, she was from the eastern end of the county, way past Haines City and almost at the border. And she was kind of content to sit and wait, but she was physically ill. She had not eaten. She was thirsty. And when I was talking to her, she also said that she was just diagnosed with leukemia, and so she wasn't feeling very well. So eventually we sat, we gave her something to eat and something to drink and had a nice, talk with her. But it just kind of brings home the point that when we are such a large county and finite offices and areas in which people can be served, that in some cases we're doing a disservice to many different people. So looking at the traditional ways that we used to do things versus providing more community-based care. Traditionally, you make the phone call. Many of y'all done this with your own situations, and you may be put on hold for a long time. You may then finally get your appointment. There may be a waiting list, but and it could be very frustrating. So one of the things that we focus on is just kind of the understanding that people can't always get to their traditional appointments. There's the matter of economics. There's a lot of poverty. People don't have cars. They don't have the money to pay for gas. The bus system, it's limited. It only goes so far, and the connections are only, so good. There's also, like I mentioned with this lady, physical. There's physical inabilities to get up and get around and, walk through the car and jump up on a curb and go up through some stairs. And, there's, those issues as well. The emotional issues, the issues that people have in terms of that they're in denial. They may have some mental health problems, but they don't want to really accept it. Or they just feel like that I can handle this by myself. And as we know, that typically doesn't fare well in the long term. So, and this has been mentioned before, the stigma, coming into a mental health center sometimes is an upsetting thing for people to do. They work up a lot of courage before they make that first appointment. And so that's something that we're constantly trying to, work on as well and reduce the feeling of that. But in terms of some of the community-based programs that we, as well as other agencies, have, I just wanted to kind of talk to you a little bit about a couple of our programs. This is a new one. It's called the Specialized Community Care Team. And this is a grant that's been made possible through the half-cent sales tax that you all have talked about. The target is the uninsured and the underinsured individuals of our county. They also have to, qualify financially, which, of course, since poverty is such an issue, that's usually not a problem. The goal is to assist those individuals with their mental health issues. There's a lot of evaluations that go on, supportive counseling, and case management. And what we do is the services are primarily in the home. We go out to them. They do not have to come to us. Now, they can always come to us if they want because, as you can imagine, some people don't want us in their homes. And that's perfectly fine. But we find that the majority of the people that we work with, they're fine with that. They want us there. and so that we can go in there and evaluate what's going on. And typically what we find, as many of you all have probably seen too, the major focus is on the basics. A lot of people don't have food, they don't have clothing, they don't have a job, their housing is very tentative. So you can't really say, well, we're going to work on your self-esteem, we're going to work on being self-actualized. You can't. Until you deal with these basic living and survival issues, then you can move on to some other things. And so that's the focus of the specialized community care team. Referrals come from the medical sites associated with the Polk County Indigent Health Program and community partners such as inpatient units. A lot of the inpatient units will discharge individuals into the community after they provided service. Well, sometimes they discharge them to a shelter or, you know, a friend's house that said he could stay with them. But then there's no real follow-up, and these people just kind of drift. And so those are the kind of people that we actually try to engage at discharge from the inpatient units. Outpatient programs refer, physicians refer, and we've gotten self-referrals. So it's been a very successful program, and we hope that we can continue in that vein. Another in-home community-based program is what's called TANF, Temporary Assistance for Needy Families. It's government assistance to those individuals who have children. And we also go out and provide services to them, evaluating what's going on. Typically, we get quite a few referrals from the courts. There's issues of domestic violence that has been going on and substance abuse. So the goal of that program is family stabilization and to assist people in getting and maintaining employment. Because again, it's those basic needs that we need to try to make sure that they have. Traditionally, in outpatient services, we still do a lot of community work for people that do come in. We do case management services. We do a lot of care coordination. A lot of us share the same people. We know the same names. And so, you know, a lot of our agencies get together and we're in the same, you know, case reviews and various venues to discuss plans and what needs to go on. And a lot of that is, you know, out in the community work. So we want to make sure that we maintain that. Currently, we also are, we've got a contract with Polk County Schools. So we are in 120 plus schools reaching out to, you can imagine all the schools in Polk County. You know, so that's truly community-based. And then we can capture the kids where they're working and playing. There's no no-shows, they're there. And so that's another way that we can kind of spread out. And, you know, just in terms of what's going on now and in the future, you know, technology is a wonderful thing. We all use it for all kind of reasons. There's telehealth. There's now applications for your smartphone. You could, you know, show your strep throat to your doctor. And those are the kind of things that, you know, in mental health and in other agencies, where we're looking to use those things, and they're out there. Regulations just have to kind of catch up, and the policies need to catch up, but it's there, and it's not going to be long. Mobile units, much like the mobile crisis team, you know, we kind of foresee buses that can go out to these far-reaching areas of our county and be able to make distance not the reason anymore for which people cannot attend. We are acutely aware that individuals that go out into the community, it's sometimes dangerous, as you all very well know. And so you have to be really acutely aware of signs and symptoms of what people are having with mental health issues. And so Margo Flesher with the Center for Our Behavioral Health Network is going to talk a little more about that. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. It's great to be here today, to see so many of my friends and to be a part of this. I wanted to give maybe a quick summary of what we've heard so far. We heard from Dr. Slate talking about some of his early experiences working as a professional in the criminal justice system, and then his experiences with the development of a mental illness. And we heard some things about what happened because he didn't realize he had a mental illness, and because other people didn't realize he had a mental illness. And then also some things that happened because there was some delay in him getting some of the care that would have helped him with some of the losses that he experienced. But then we heard from a lot of these eminent providers in our field about different types of care that people can receive and ways that these organizations have done so much that they can do to make care accessible to people in Polk County. Like, we heard from Dr. Haight about how counseling services are available alongside primary health services so that people can recognize the signs and symptoms of behavioral health conditions as they develop. And treatment of both can increase the chances that people are going to have good progress with both their health conditions and their mental health conditions. And we heard from Kirk Fasshauer at Peace River Center about how crisis services are available 24 hours a day. And there's mobile crisis teams that can go to people when they're in need. They can go out to us. We heard from Don Van Stee about how having a co-occurring substance use condition and a mental health condition doesn't have to be a barrier to people receiving the care that they need, and much can be done to reduce that stigma. There's a no wrong door policy for people to receive care for their behavioral health needs in the co-occurring disorders philosophy. And we heard from Jeff Ware about some newer programs that make services accessible to people in their homes, out in the community, and also we know at the Center for Behavioral Health there are services people can walk in and receive when they need them. There's counseling services that people can receive without an appointment. So there's all of this available to us, but still here we are. We need your help. We need to help each other. One thing we know, Kirk Fasshauer mentioned it, 1 in 5 Americans experience a mental disorder in any given year. That could be something like depression, that could be something like anxiety, sometimes it could be bipolar disorder or schizophrenia. The lifetime prevalence of a mental disorder in the United States is 46%. So 1 in 5 in any given year, or 46%, or nearly half over a lifetime. Now, for everyone, that doesn't mean that people are going to need to go in the hospital or have care long term. Maybe sometimes people can kind of keep trudging through and they can resolve their behavioral health issues or their emotional crisis, and with a lot of support that we have with our families and our friends in our community, that isn't too much of a problem. But then also sometimes we need help. We need help from our community services. So what we do know is if people receive early intervention, if people receive ongoing support, and people receive treatment, it can prevent an illness from getting worse. It can prevent a lot of the losses that people experience. We know that the median length of time between someone having major depression and getting help is 8 years. A lot can happen in 8 years to a person with depression. Job losses, relationship losses, effects to their health. So why aren't people getting the help that they need? Well, a lot of reasons, and we do agree that services could be funded better, and we could all use some more resources. But that's not exactly why we're here today, because we can't do as much about that today as we can do about the stigma that we keep hearing about. And we can do something about the lack of awareness in our communities and the need for information that we have in our communities. So that is why we are here today, because we also know that people will get help for their mental health condition if someone close to them encourages them and gives them information and encouragement. So I had a little information in your slides. I think I should explain this to you. This is just a little bit extra, because we talked about how, say, for instance, people experiencing depression, it could be a median length of time of 8 years. So for half of people with depression, it's longer than 8 years, and for half of people with depression, it's a little less than 8 years. But it could be that long before they get help for their mental illness. This was just some information that kind of woke me up about the amount of people receiving behavioral health services. And this is information from the University of South Florida Criminal Justice Mental Health and Substance Abuse Technical Assistance Center about people in contact with the criminal justice system who received behavioral health services. So out of all those people who contacted the criminal justice system, 4% received mental health care, less than 1% received substance abuse services, and about 0.3% of those individuals received co-occurring services or integrated services for substance abuse and mental health. That doesn't mean that those services that are available to people that are criminal justice involved aren't good. But it does mean that there's a need, and this may not be a system that is meant to handle all of that need. So again, we need to help each other. So the good news is, I didn't think that would be in there. The good news is, when we share information with each other about behavioral health needs and conditions and how actually common it is for people to experience the symptoms of a mental illness or the symptoms of a crisis, people can get to the help they need, and people can get into recovery faster, and they can stay in recovery longer, and they can have a better outcome. We can be the help that someone needs. You might be the help that someone needs. You might be the help that I need. So I love talking about mental health first aid. That was a great suggestion from Dr. Haight. He said, wouldn't it be great if there was some kind of first aid for people with mental health conditions? And here it is. Now, I really love mental health first aid. I feel really privileged to be able to know this model and to share it with communities and share it with organizations. They sent me out in 2013 to take this training, to receive the training that everybody receives, and then to receive instructor training. And I said to myself, what am I going to learn with 20 years in the field of behavioral health and experiences as a counselor about mental health first aid? Well, turns out a whole lot. I learned a lot about really what behavioral health issues are in our community from a more neighborhood level, from a more community level. And it made me understand why when I'm out in the community and I don't have my counselor hat on, and I don't have my program manager hat on, and if someone comes to me and says, Margo, I need your help, and then I'm not taken aback because I'm like, wow, I'm not at my office with all those resources that I have available to me. What do? I can help someone. And I came to understand, too, that most of the time when someone comes to us for help, it's not because they want a counselor. They want a friend who's informed. They want a coworker. They want a parent, a sister, or a brother. My 15-year-old son will tell me all the time, don't use that counseling on me because I just don't want that. He wants mom, or he wants something other than that. So that's what mental health first aid can do for us. It is an evidence-based model, 8-hour certification training program that teaches people what different mental health conditions can look like, what it's like to try to talk to someone if they're in crisis, and how to help them. It's the help that we can provide to people until the professional help arrives. It helps them get to those great services that we have available here in Polk County that you just heard about earlier. There's many great models of mental health first aid that we can use to meet the needs of your group, your family, your interests. There's an adult model that talks about mental health issues in the United States and our communities. Really great hands-on information. There's a youth model. There's a lot of great activity going on with youth mental health first aid in our Polk County schools through the Project Aware grant and the programs that have been brought to our Polk County schools. There's a Spanish version. I cannot help with the Spanish version, but we can locate someone who is certified to teach that one. There are supplements to the curriculum that are specific to certain types of settings. There is a mental health first aid for law enforcement, public safety, and first responders. That's really excellent. There is one for higher education, for older adults, for veterans and military members. So there's going to be a mental health first aid that's a good fit for whatever questions and interests that you have for this model. So the good news is we have information about how you can access mental health first aid. Please visit us over at the Central Florida Behavioral Health Network table. We're right next to the folks, the friendly folks at Peace River Center, outside in the lobby, and talk about how you can either take a course or bring a course to your organization. And we can work together on strengthening our awareness in Polk County. So now Judge Williams will be coming back to field some more questions.
Will.
Sure. Thank you, Margot. I had the privilege of enrolling and taking that 8-hour mental health first aid course, and extremely beneficial. So I would encourage you, if you have an opportunity, get with Margot, and she will get you lined up for it. Let's take a little time now to just touch on some questions that you've come up with. We've got some time, correct, our timekeeper? Good. Let me just announce the question, and then we'll see which panelist is best suited to tackle it. First question, will the CIT teams work with all age groups?
Yes.
Okay, easy
short
answer.
Sweet, yeah. And yeah, they're, we talk about children's issues as well as adult issues and the geriatric population so that we have an understanding. Because sometimes with the geriatric population, some physical ailments can mimic that of mental illness. So kind of trying to distinguish that. And that helps the officers out in the community have a better understanding of where to guide the individual to go if they need that.
Good. Some of us are dealing with parents who are aging. I know I am. And we know of the geriatric side to mental health, and we need to be paying attention to that. Second question, who can refer to the specialized community care team? Does the referral come from a primary care physician? Can a social worker make that referral?
Anyone can make a referral to the specialized community care team.
Okay.
It's 291-3611.
That was my next follow-up question.
3611.
One more time, Jeff.
291-3611.
Okay.
Area code 863.
So you have the way to make that referral, and anyone can make that referral. Great question, great answer. What is the difference between substance abuse and substance use? Which term is used now? Is it based on DSM-5?
Well, the old term was substance abuse, and now they're using a term called substance use disorder. I guess that's a more politically correct way of doing it, but that's how they define it now, as a substance use disorder, and that's what we use.
Okay, hopefully that answers the question. We keep watching these terms change, those of us that work in these fields consistently, and I almost feel as if it's our responsibility to stay right at the edge. If substance use disorder is the proper terminology, then let's use that. That's at least how I feel, and I've encouraged my team to do just that. How does a parent recognize warning signs that differentiate between a young child acting out versus exhibiting more serious trouble? Looks like Margot's gonna try and pose an answer.
I love that question because that's one of the questions that's answered by Youth Mental Health First Aid. It helps us differentiate between what might be some of the usual types of storms and stresses, say, of adolescence that our young people go through and what might be a sign of the developing mental health condition or a substance use disorder. Because as a lot of us know, that's the age, late teens, early 20s, that a lot of people experience the onset of a mental disorder. So that's in mental health first aid for youth.
A little more time or not? Okay, we're going to cut it off right there. If the question that you asked has not been addressed or answered, certainly there's ways to get answers to those questions. Now, let me try to wrap this up. I would like for Dr. Slate to kind of come full circle and tell us the rest of that story, if you would, please.
Well, first of all, let me say I have a new doctor. It's not the one that took me off the medication, right? Got rid of him. The new doctor has, actually I've had several new doctors. They've all done wonderful jobs. And I don't know if any of you care, but I take lithium and I take 450 milligrams twice a day. And it's my drug of choice, and it does a wonderful job. So as I was saying before, we need the formal structures in place. We have them here. Recovery is indeed possible. And there was a Will Smith was interviewed when he played the role of Ali in the movie Ali. I don't know if any of you saw it. And Will Smith is a Scientologist, but let's not hold that against him. Because in this instance, Will was asked, what it felt like to play the role of Muhammad Ali. And he said, there's something cathartic about getting knocked down and standing back up. And there is. And I have. And, I think they mentioned in your bio that you were appointed by Governor Bush. I was actually appointed by Governor Bush also to the Mental Health and Substance Abuse Commission here in Florida. And on one of my trips as part of that, going around the state looking at mental health and substance abuse, I went back to Jackson Memorial Hospital in Miami. And I saw the very place that I'd been hospitalized. But I was able to walk in as a member of the Governor's Commission and walk out in the same day. And that was powerful. I also was able to testify before Congress, U.S. House of Representatives Judiciary Committee, and our panel ended up getting federal funding for mental health courts. And when we talk about stigma, stigma is in language, too. And I appreciate the fact that you all changed the name of the mental health court in Polk County to the behavioral health court. Because, mental health court sends off certain messages. And we have to be careful about language. I know that a while back, you may recall this, Southeastern, maybe some Southeastern folks in here, and God love you, and I care for you, but Southeastern wanted to name their new football team the Maniacs. And I went on a letter-writing campaign to the Ledger about, what kind of message are you sending if you were going to call your football team the Maniacs? There are people who have had manic episodes. That's not something you should be doing. That's not something you should joke about. They're the fire now, and I hope they win every game they play, because Florida Southern doesn't have a team, so I'll say that. Language is important. The other thing is we are attacking stigma on a better basis these days. In fact, I was watching Sunday. I play fantasy football. I love football. I'm watching pro football shows on Sunday. And if anybody watched the show with Terry Bradshaw and Howie Long and Michael Strahan and Jimmy Johnson, the show that comes on noon on Fox. Did you see the lapel pin they were wearing? They were wearing a NAMI pin, National Alliance on Mental Illness. And that's what you start doing. You start taking people that are celebrities out there, and they've got the power to change this thing. And so they've done it. Britney Spears is bipolar. I guess it's cool to be bipolar now because Britney is. You know, so that's what it's going to take if we're going to overcome stigma, and it is a great inhibitor. But I basically came to the conclusion after what happened to me, and me trying to stay in a closet about being mentally ill, after what happened to me, you know what? It could happen to anybody. And we've got to stop it from happening to people. And so we've got to overcome the stigma. We've got to get the right people in place like we have here today. And we've got to make sure that proper treatment is taken care of. And again, as I said before, people should not have to commit a crime to get adequate treatment within our society. Thank you for being here.
All right. Let me just say a couple things in closing to you. First of all, this is important, folks. This is the right thing to do. I use those words consistently in what we do in our behavioral health court and in our problem-solving courts generally. We got to do the right thing. I want to thank our panelists for the information that you've provided to each of us and for your participation. Tremendous. And to you. Yes, let's give them a hand. I think that many of us are going to stand by just a few minutes, and if you have any individual or personal questions that you'd like to address one-on-one, we'd certainly try to meet and greet you and address those things. And so thank you to you. We couldn't do this engagement session without you. And so we appreciate your presence and your participation in the process and for your engagement. And as I close many court sessions with, go forth with success. Thank you.